Good morning, everyone. I hereby call to order the 12th meeting of the Public Utility Commission for calendar year 2014 and ask that you join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first matter on this morning's agenda is the approval of the minutes from the June 5th meeting, and it's a pleasure to recognize Vice Chairman Coleman as the editor of the minutes. Vice Chairman.
Thank you, Chairman. I have reviewed the minutes of the June 5th, 2014 public meeting, and I move they be approved as submitted.
I second the motion.
Any discussion? Any objections? Hearing none, the minutes are approved as submitted. It's a pleasure to welcome to the podium to begin public meeting this morning, Ms. Cheryl Walker Davis.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
May it please this Honorable Commission, on behalf of your various offices and bureaus, we present for your consideration and disposition the following agenda items, commencing this morning with matters on behalf of the Office of Special Assistance. It is recommended, with regard to the first item pertaining to the interconnection arbitration petition of Core Communications and Windstream, that the Commission adopt the Bureau's recommendation, noting the statement of your statement, Mr. Chairman, as well as the statement of Commissioner Brown, which I believe is an oral statement to be followed by a written statement.
So moved.
Second.
I'd like to recognize Commissioner Brown for purposes of her oral statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to point out that I have a couple of concerns with the matter before us, procedural and substantive concerns. On the procedural grounds, I think that waiting until 5 months after the issuance of a secretarial letter asking the parties to address the FCC's ICC order constitutes a waiver of any objection to the Commission's asking for the most recent information. I think that CORE's responsive filings, including their affidavits, which address the FCC's ICC USF order, should be included in any of our analysis. CORE's change business plan should also be considered because it involves matters addressed in the ICC USF order. It also avoids any potential error of law claim that might arise, alleging that we violated Pennsylvania precedent, which prohibits the Commission from ignoring recent information. On substantive grounds, the Commission should consider a more inclusive definition of what constitutes Windstream's facilities under state and federal law. In addition, the Commission should address the appropriate compensation for voice and dial-up internet access services based on the FCC and Commission precedent on rating telephone numbers and the ISP remand order. There should be no threshold triggers for direct interconnection. The parties must compensate each other for services rendered, including transport services that is not short haul switch access transport. Excuse me. The standard for deciding if a call is local or long distance based on an NPA NXX for voice services turns on the rating of the NPA NXX on not the geographic or endpoints, turns on the rating of the NPA NXX, not the geographic or endpoints of the NPA NXX. Finally, Windstream may not have to interconnect with CORE's facilities, but this does not mean that Windstream should not have to compensate CORE if CORE has to provide transmission services. So it's for these reasons that I will be voting no, and I will be issuing a written statement to be added for the record.
Thank you, Commissioner Brown. I simply would like to add into the record a conflict statement this morning regarding this case that Norman Kennard did not advise me in this particular case. Is there any further discussion?
Yes, Chairman, I wish to be recorded as no also.
Thank you, Commissioner Cawley. Any objections? We'll note, I believe, the objections of Commissioner Cawley and Commissioner Brown, and the motion passes 3-2.
It is recommended that the Commission adopt the next staff recommendation in the proceeding involving Core Communications, Inc. and CenturyLink, that being a petition for reconsideration and clarification of the Commission's final order on interconnection arbitration, noting your statement, Mr. Chairman, as well as the statement of Commissioner Brown.
So moved.
Second.
I just simply, again, like to have my conflict statement entered into the record here on this case. Again, that Norman Kennard did not advise me on this particular matter. And I'd like to recognize Commissioner Brown for purposes of her statement. Commissioner Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will be submitting my written statement for the record, but let me summarize it. The Commission and FCC precedent correctly distinguishes between using VNXX to provide voice service and using VNXX to provide dial-up internet access service. When VNXX is used to provide voice service, precedent holds that it is the rating of the NPA NXX, not the endpoint or geography which controls. When VNXX is used for dial-up internet access service, the rate should reflect the ISP remand order rate cap of 0.007 per minute of use. Second, the Commission should not refrain from imposing the obligation to remit compensation from one party to another in this dispute whenever a third party is involved, because those third parties are not parties to this dispute. This could encourage a party to use third-party arrangements to deliver voice over internet protocol or wireless to avoid the obligation to reimburse the other party in those costs. CenturyLink cannot use third-party arrangements that shift costs to CORE any more than CORE should be able to use third-party arrangements to shift their costs to CenturyLink. When third-party arrangements do that, it is an arrangement that comes within this interconnection agreement. This also avoids the claim that allowing this to happen is a departure from our precedent, which holds it is not public policy in Pennsylvania to permit wholesale interconnection service without compensation. So for these reasons, I will be voting no.
So noted. Any further discussion?
I also wish to be recorded as voting no.
So noted, Commissioner Cawley. Hearing no further objections, the motion passes 3-2.
Continuing with the presentation of public meeting agenda items on behalf of the Office of Special Assistance, it is recommended in omnibus fashion that the Commission adopt all recommendations appearing on pages 2 and 3 through and including the recommendation pertaining to the joint petition to adopt an interconnection agreement between Verizon Pennsylvania LLC and RCLEC Inc.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Any objections? Hearing none, the motion passes unanimously.
Turning now to matters on behalf of the Bureau of Technical Utility Services, commencing on page 4, it is recommended that the Commission adopt all of the items appearing on pages 4, 5, and the first two items through and including the application of PA Department of Transportation in the middle of page 6.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Any objections? Hearing none, the motion passes unanimously.
With regard to the petition of the UGI Utilities Inc. Gas Division for the adoption of a long-term infrastructure improvement plan, there is your motion, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I'd like to have my motion entered into the record here this morning. This is in regards to UGI's long-term infrastructure improvement plan. Our review of UGI's LTIP is set against a backdrop of a settlement approved by the Commission on February 19th, 2013, which arose from the fatal gas explosion in Allentown back in February of 2011. The terms of the settlement required UGI to accelerate the replacement of bare steel cast mains and prohibited UGI from charging a DISC until April of 2015. One of the main criteria that the Commission must use in judging the adequacy of an LTIP is whether the plan accelerates the replacement of aging infrastructure. Further, for companies that have already begun the accelerated replacement of infrastructure, we previously stated that LTIPs should demonstrate how a DISC mechanism will maintain or augment acceleration of infrastructure and prudent capital investment. I should take an opportunity to remind the Philadelphia Gas Works about accelerated replacement of aged infrastructure, but that's not about PGW here this morning, it's about UGI. Accordingly, since UGI has already begun accelerating the replacement of its infrastructure under the terms of the aforementioned settlement, the proposed plan must demonstrate maintenance of that acceleration. A thorough review of UGI's LTIP shows that the proposed replacement schedule maintains the level set forth in the settlement agreement dating back to February of 2013. Sets the settlement in the acceleration over historic replacement level. As such, I believe the approval of the LTIP is warranted here this morning. Therefore, I move that the Bureau of Technical Utility Services prepare an opinion and order consistent with this motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Any objections? Hearing none, the motion passes unanimously.
In omnibus fashion, it is recommended that the Commission adopt the recommendations on behalf of the Bureau of Technical Utility Services, commencing with the last item on the bottom of page 6 pertaining to the application of A.A. Atkinson Moving, Inc., and continuing with all items appearing on pages 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11 through and including the recommendation regarding the registration of PPL Electric Utilities Corporation Security Certificate.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? I do have one discussion point. First, I want to commend staff. We have approvals here for some new electric and gas energy suppliers in the market. I particularly want to commend staff because of the work that they put forth in reminding these new entities that are going to be entering into the marketplace to adhere to the new protocol set in the recent 5-0 decision at the Independent Regulatory Review Commission proceeding. So again, I want to commend staff for reiterating that to these new companies that are going to be entering the marketplace when it comes to disclosures to customers. We do have a second from the Vice Chairman. Any discussion? Any objections? Hearing none, these motions pass unanimously.
Turning now to matters on behalf of the Law Bureau, it is recommended that the Commission adopt on page 12 the recommendation of the proceeding involving Air Voice Wireless LLC's petition for approval to be designated as an eligible telecommunications carrier.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Any objections? Hearing none, the motion passes unanimously.
And on behalf of the Office of Administrative Law Judge, on page 13, it is recommended that the Commission adopt ALJ Cheskis's recommended decision regarding the settlement in the City of Bethlehem water rate case.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Any objections? Hearing none, the motion passes unanimously.
With that concluding the presentation of regular agenda items, we turn now to the carrying agenda. It is recommended on behalf of the Office of Competitive Market Oversight that the Commission adopt the recommendation with regard to the rulemaking pertaining to the request for clarification of the applicability of the Commission's electric disclosure and contract renewal notice requirements.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Any objections? Hearing none, the motion passes unanimously. Are there any other items to come before the Commission? I believe not. A very quick public meeting here this morning. And we will adjourn on that note, but we'll be reconvening for a quick, not a quick, because we were recognizing the great Herb Norick here, but we are adjourned on that note.